I don't know why that's the only station, but that's the only station. Boca Tov. Here's the beach, obviously. Feels about 40, 50 degrees. There's a hotel, it's called The Seasons. It's a pretty good morning so far.
We'll be using it only off the bus. I just turned mine on, and to turn it on you have to press on the orange button that is on the side of the speaker of the machine, and you should have number 49. 49. You have it? Turn it on. I have also left for each one of you next to the machine an ear pierce, and you have to put it through the opening that is on the top, and you have to push the needle all the way through. Don't leave even 1 millimeter out, otherwise you will not have a good connection. Now put that one, that the ear pierce on your ear, and try to listen me through it. I'm going to activate mine and see if you can hear me. Can you hear me?
We're not that quick.
Take your time. I'll give you another couple of minutes. Okay, who doesn't hear me? I'm talking through my mic.
I can't find the ear pierce.
You can't find the ear pierce? I left it on the seat. If not, then when we leave out, then I have the bag in the back, that's why. I will give you one. It's in a small plastic bag. It's not a big deal, I have a lot of them. So, all y'all, the others, you hear me? You're okay? Okay, when you come on the bus, you have to deactivate it so you can see it on your battery. It's much better. Pressing the orange button as well, another time, until the LCD is off. There is no number on it, on the top. That's it.
It's staticky.
While driving on this back road, which I like actually a lot, I would like you to notice the cliff that is front left. You see it? Yes?
Yes.
Very good. This is part of what we call the ridge, the Kurkar Ridge. The Kurkar Ridge is a sand rock ridge. And this
but Herod the Great, remember, has built it out of nothing. There was nothing over here. This over here, the whole land is part of the Sharon Plain. The north is where Eric's standing in the land of Lebanon. The south is where John is standing, let's say in Egypt, all the way. The east where you're standing, ladies over there, I don't know your name because your name is no legs, and this is the lamb on the shoulder. Okay, the god of fertility over there. Okay. And this is a statue, maybe to a ruler, maybe to one of the Caesars, we don't know. You always see this is a good one.
Yes. of stone.
It's amazing.
Cut my hand too. I quarried. Labor was cheap.
Things, take your picture, and we will be going on.
Public Works Project.
It was beautiful. It's the coolest place I've ever been. Where the theater was back behind that wall. Drum. Fortress.
Crossing through the gate into the area of the ex-Herodian harbor, as well as the fortress of Louis the Ninth, that was destroyed by Vipers in the year 1065. Follow me, y'all, please.
Go and dive, of course.
Let's do it.
And you said this is about 125 feet?
No, 750
and 300 feet. 150
feet. 150
feet.
Yes, about 150 feet. Yes. So, if you have no question, take your picture. We're going towards the area of the Crusader Gate out to the bus, but we will be stopping at the modern bathrooms of Caesarea for whoever wants to.
This place is huge. That's a good looking dog. Jezreel Valley.
He was already identifying the gate just from standing on top of it, because it was all covered with dirt, and he was just...
Check alert. Very good lady. Well, the first thing I would like to start with is the orientation from where we are.
you're looking from the west towards the east of the country, we are on the west edge of the Jezreel Valley. We are within the premises of the kingdom of Megiddo. Towards my left, towards the north, you can see in the far corner a high ridge, and that is the Carmel Ridge, Mount Carmel, where we just came from. It descends down onto another ridge, you see, towards the north, and that would be what we call the Lower Galilee Ridge. The Lower Galilee Ridge starts from the west area and continues on a straight line towards the eastern border of the country. We call it the Lower Galilee Ridge because its altitude maximum is 2,000 feet above sea level. But if you look towards the Lower Galilee Ridge, beyond it there's another ridge, part of it is visible, higher in altitude, and that is the Upper Galilee Ridge. Like two arms like this, one is higher than the other, this is the upper and goes up to 4,000 feet above sea level. Within the Lower Galilee Ridge, we do have on that nose-like coming down south a little bit what we call the Nazareth Ridge, which is part of the Lower Galilee Ridge. But because of the town of Nazareth that is built on it, we have given that name to that part of the ridge as the Nazareth Ridge. From the Nazareth Ridge, if we descend in the hay straight ahead, can you see a mountain there? A lonely mountain? That is Mount Tabor or Tabor. That is the location where Deborah was standing with Barak. This is the direction where Sisera has headed towards them to bring them back to slavery. And we got stuck in the mud of this fertile land. You can see the soil, how beautiful it is. And that is also the location in the New Testament for the Eastern and the Western churches as the site of the Transfiguration. Okay? We'll talk later about it when we are in the area of Mount Hermon. Mount Tabor, to the right of it, there is another ridge of a mountain. You see it? That is called Mount Moriah. Not Moriah. That is in Jerusalem. Remember? Moriah. It's a Hebrew word and it means teacher. The mountain of the teacher. Mount Moriah, by the way, is very important biblically for us. There are three super important locations on Mount Moriah for us as Christians. The eastern slopes of Mount Moriah have a town that exists until now, and it's called Endor. And that should ring a bell immediately with the witch of Endor, that King Saul, the first king of Israel, went down to that maiden and asked her to bring the spirit of Prophet Samuel to him. On the western slopes of the Mount Moriah, not that town, but more to the right, there is another town until nowadays, we pronounce it in our colloquial way of nowadays, Sulam. And it is the original Shunem, where the Shunammite women used to live over there, who believed that Elisha is a holy man, a man of God. And she built an upper room, another time, the upper room, remember? For him. And because she did that, she was barren, he prayed for God Almighty to give her a son. And he did, but eventually that son died. So she placed him on the bed of that holy man in the upper room, walked from there through the valley towards Mount Carmel to the dwelling location of Prophet Elisha, and called him to come and fix her son for her. 2 Kings chapter 4, the miracle is at. The third miracle that has happened on Mount Moriah would be in the Gospel of Luke chapter 7, starting verse 11. There is another time, until today, a town that is called Nain or Nain, the way you like to pronounce it. And that would be where the widow of Nain was, taking her son to the tomb, to the cemetery, to bury him. And when our Lord Jesus Christ saw her wailing and crying, he had compassion on her. He stopped the funeral. He touched the coffin. And then he called him back from the dead. Remember, he touched the coffin. And he called her or him back from the death. and everyone was praising God. So that is the area of Neen or Nain. We come down, there's a valley, you see the opening? That is what we call the Bechan Valley, that people used to travel through down to Bechan. Okay, that connects between Bechan itself and the Bechan Valley and the plain of the Armageddon or the Jezreel Valley. And to its right, we have another ridge of the mountain, and that is called the Gilboa Mountain. Gilboa Mountain immediately should give you an idea about the war that King Saul has fought against Philistine, the Philistines, and there he died. And a good summer clear day, between the Gilboa Mountain and Moriah Mountain, through the Bechan Valley, you will see in the back another mountain, and that is the Gilead Mountains, in Jordan of nowadays. In the country of Jordan of nowadays, but now the crowd is there. Behind me, towards the south, the ridge of the mountain starts, and that is the beginning of the Samaritan Bridge. And we'll talk later on the bus, from where the Samaritan name was from, and what does it mean, okay? But that is the beginning of the Samaritan Bridge. That is the place where Pharaoh Necho of Egypt was coming through the Dothan Valley, all the way to Assyria, to help the Assyrians against the Babylonians, and the King Hosea of Jerusalem, of Israel, did not want him to have to help. So he came up to encounter the mighty Pharaoh Necho, and he killed him. The king was brought first over here and then carried down to Jerusalem where he was buried. So that is the beginning of the Samaritan Ridge. And one day we will be there and we will be visiting Jacob's well as well. Okay? So that is the orientation that you have all the surrounding over here. But the most important chunk of it is the plain itself that is in front of you. What they call the Armageddon. There are many explanations made by many theologians about the end times. And is it going to happen only over here or different parts, but one of the major battles would be fought over here? Or what is going to happen? I always say be ready and just don't worry about what's going to happen. But I like to visualize it, reading the Word of God in this way. I like to visualize it like this. When the tribulation will start by the Antichrist declaring himself as God to be worshipped in Jerusalem and stationing his picture at the temple that he will rebuild in Jerusalem, the tribulation we will not pass. God loves us that will not pass the tribulation. We will be lifted up in a second like this, and we will be with our Lord Jesus Christ and all the faithful ones who have died before us. The ones who are friends or relatives to us, and I know that you have lots of them as much as I do, and they are not faithful to Jesus, they are not born again, they are not Christians by faith, they will look around and say, oh, where is Eric? Where is John? Where is Raul? Where is thousands, millions of people have disappeared. Oh, they were telling us that they will be caught up, and we were laughing at them. Oh, God, forgive us. And they will become believers, but it's too late for them to be lifted up. They have to pass throughout the whole tribulation. For these 7 years, they have to suffer. They will be killed. And then the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with the heavenly host and with us. And thus he will destroy the Antichrist and all his followers. And he will set his rule on earth for 1,000 years. And I like to think about it like this. The life span of man will be as creation was from the very beginning, up to 1,000 years. Which means who did not die will live for 1,000 years. Who would be born would live throughout this 1,000 year. And at the end, or towards the end of the 1,000 year, the earth would be filled with people again. and God will open again these gates and let the devil go out for a period of time. Who will mislead these people after being with God for so long. And thus, the judgment, the final judgment will come. They will be thrown in Hades. The gates would be locked and we would live with God forever. This is one of the so many explanations I have read about the end times that I like, actually, to think that it's going to happen in this way. But if it is not going to happen in this way, if it's going to happen in another way, there is one very important thing that should be, and that we believe in our Lord Jesus Christ, we are saved through Him, and whatever way is going to happen, we will be with Him. Any question?
Which way is north, Rao?
That is north, and that is south, and that is the east, and behind you is the west. And we're going to that side if there is no question. Have a quick look at the pagan worship that God at that time. The lower you go, the more back in history you go. But the most impressive one of all these, you see these rectangular shapes? These are all layers of temples that they used to worship within at that time. But the most fascinating one would be the round one that is over there. That goes back to about 2900 BC, before Christ. You know, let me tell you this piece of information, because I believe that many of the people around you who wants to question God Almighty, you must have been asked why God was a bloody God in the Old Testament. He allowed for the killing of all these Canaanites. He allowed the killing and the butchering of so and so and the Amalekites. He's a loving God. He's a faithful God. Why did He allow all this killing and butchering? I can give you a good answer. God is not a God. God is God and He's a loving God. But God has limits, especially when you start misleading others astray and not worship God Almighty. Remember what we spoke about on the mountain there? Even the nation of Israel, when they went away from God and after so many warnings, the gates of heaven were closed. Here the Canaanites were going after false gods. And so many messengers, I believe, has been sent to them, but they did not want to adhere to the worship of one God. And they were worshiping many gods, and not only that, but in a very wicked way. Asherah, you heard her name? Asherah is the god of fertility. And they used to worship her in September. September should be having the first rainfall in the country, so that the Jezreel Valley will be irrigated. No watering system at that time, no sprinklers. Okay? So that their god Asherah would be happy, or her husband, sorry, would be happy.
Man down.
That's a good thing.
Wow. Ahab's son.
Yeah.
pretty cool. King Ahab built this. Thirsty?
Yeah.
Beyond the metal gate, I will go in front of you. I know that there's a chemical toilet there. I have to use the bathroom.
A mechanical toilet. Free at last. That was a little difficult.
We'll go up together to the second floor where the offices and where you're going to start. And there is a local guide that will take you through the whole complex. You will start.
Hello. increase my labor a little bit.
Yeah. I will give you a job application for my dear, okay? Think about this. Thank you.
Yay.
Now we are passing through the kitchen and we are going upstairs to see another house. Watch your steps. In your church or your churches, if you are working with kids, this is a nice activity to do with them. And in your schools as well, or home.
And part of Syria, Trachonides as was known at that time, that would be for Herod Philip, whom he built a capital for himself, for his area. And of course they all want to please the Caesar. So what did he do? He built a capital at the foot of Mount Hermon, and he called it Caesarea, in dedication of the Caesar Tiberius. And to differentiate it from his father Caesarea, we started calling it after his name as well, Caesarea Philip, Philippi. The same one that is mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 16. Running from the right to the left and entering the entry of the Jordan into the Sea of Galilee. If you look to the right now, here it is, you see it? Yeah, and to the left. So this is where it comes into the Sea of Galilee. And many people, when they see this Jordan, they are disappointed, because they expect to see the Nile or the Mississippi. Not at all. The smallest creek that you have in America
Little Stonehenge.
And the walls, they lifted them up, but these are the original pieces, but they reassembled. This everything was under dirt. The level was up there, so you are now in the excavated area. You okay? You can... There's a comfortable glass all over there. A channel of water that fits the mikveh where you are sitting. That's the entry. And it's filled with water because it has been raining. That's an original mikveh. They said no, and they said even we are in the desert, God will provide.
Things not on.
So the power of the devil is strong, and the power of the devil, whenever they are faithful people, praying, he tries to interrupt and to stop block their prayer by distracting them from being worshipped towards the Lord Almighty. If you go into churches nowadays, you see lots of icons, lots of statues. And
messing around. They got shade and everything.
Chariots, and all these kings joined their forces and came and encamped together at the waters of Merom to fight with Israel. And the Lord said to Joshua, "Do not be afraid of them, for tomorrow at this time I will give over all of them slain to Israel. You shall hamstring their horses and burn their chariots with fire." So Joshua and all his warriors came suddenly against them by the waters of Merom and fell upon them. And the Lord gave them into the hands of Israel, who struck them and chased them as far as Great Sidon and Mizrapoth-Maim and eastward as far as the valley of Mitzpah. And they struck them until he left none remaining. And Joshua did to them just as the Lord said to him. He hamstrung their horses and burned their chariots with fire. And Joshua turned back at that time and captured Hazor and struck its king with a sword. For Hazor formerly was the head of all these kingdoms, and they struck with a sword all who were in it, devoting them to destruction. There was none left that breath, and he burned Hazor with fire. You know, there is one verse in the Bible that when we read, many say, "Can that happen?" And that verse was told to us by our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, if you have faith as small as the mustard seed, and I don't know if you have ever seen a mustard seed, you can ask the mountain to jump into the sea, and it will. You call it over. And then he says, it's funny figure of speech. I know one man that is in the Bible who believed that he can do so. And his name was Joshua, the son of Nun. He asked God, and he believed from his heart that God would fulfill his request.
And that reminded them immediately of the huge fire that took place over here. We are talking about the 14th century BC. At that time, mud bricks and pottery were not treated with fire. They were just dried in the sun of the summer. And they knew that if water will come on it, lots of water, it will disintegrate. That is why when they used to build with mud bricks, they used not to use it as a foundation stone, but they used to place it on the first course of the foundation stone. What was the line of the foundation stone? Basal crumble, like the one you see behind you. These are all original. Okay? From the line of the bottom and below, it's all original. And then on top, they will add them. Over here, you can see this is original mud brick, and they have added from the line and above, but from here and below is original. Okay? All these basal crumble. They took the specimens of all these ashes, and they tested them. And they found that it's all from one kind of tree, the cedars of Lebanon. You know how far Lebanon is over from here? We're very close, by the way. Very close. At that time, they used to build a lower course, mud brick up to this height, and then on top of the mud bricks, there would be huge tree trunks to support the room and to make this big room for the king. So what he did practically is that he burned all these tree trunks. Okay, and the tree trunks collapsed. It caught fire to everything, to the furniture. But one of the things that was positive for us, good for us, is that fire hardened the mud brick and did not disintegrate, and was waiting for these 3,400 years for the archaeologists to come and find it. And they did. And here we are within this palace that is mentioned in the Word of God as a fact location that it has happened. Even in the back room, the archive room, some of the cuneiform tablets, letters between the pharaohs of Egypt to the king over here and other kings have been found. And they're still under study at the Hebrew Museum. So here we are within the palace of King Jabin that was defeated not by Joshua the son of Nun, but by the power of God Almighty. Any questions? Take some pictures and do not climb, please. Watch where you step. There will always be stones coming from the ground, and you might not notice them because in the west we walk like this, in the east we walk like this, so we can see in front of us. We don't want any accidents, please. Yes, sir.
So these bricks that are above there,
this is replica.
Those are replicas.
Yes.
Over here, it looks like those are.
These are original.
Original.
Yes, and this is original even. You see the line from it and below. This is original. Oh, one thing let me tell you. We know what was the temperature of the
having faces, eyes, ears, hands, body. What we call statues. But before that, it was only standing stone.
Something to sell my here's the Temple of Zeus. Pretty cool acoustics.
Temple of Zeus.
Built around 98 AD in the days of Emperor Trajan. For the city's 100th anniversary, a marble inscription found at the site implies that it was a temple for Pan and the Zeus of Heliopolis. Only the foundations of the temple survived. Originally, it included a columnar portico behind which there stood a cella where rites were conducted. The splendid Corinthian capital seen nearby once crowned one of the four columns of the facade. Panias city coin above shows the facade of a temple with a statue of Zeus in the hall.
church is making it out of it a big issue, and it's a commemoration of 100 years of the massacre. 1915 it took place.
Beth Shean.
Are you going to go up the stairs with me, John?
It's incredible to go inside.
We'll go in there afterward. Let's get up the hill and then we'll come back down. All right. So I'll have a chance to see the whole place. Come back down. And
so this must be regional road then.
Can we read to you?
Yeah.
Epitha. Pala. Polaniog. Ortha. Polethrogroi. Polzame. Le. Holo.
long ago.
With a double. Things probably about 30, 40 feet up there.
Oh.
passing through. Usually, you cannot take pictures of checkpoints.
I heard it.
Lucky before
I'm glad you said usually.
They don't like you to take pictures of the checkpoints because it is a military facility. So if you do it, don't let them see you. Because if they see you, you know what happens. Usually they arrest the driver.
Quick.
Thank you.
This is the gate that we passed and the checkpoint, and now we are within the 1967, what is known under the title of the West Bank, and by now you know.
Kind of crooked.
Are you gonna go? Okay, because he's Ed. You're not going then, right? Okay.
Just. Like I think so. I think so.
Rides are bumpy.
Well, I'll tell you something. Much better than most.
Oh, yeah.
I'd rather walk.
Just put my luggage up on the camel.
Oh.
pretty steep.
No, these are pretty steep.
Now try going through the eye of the needle. Oh. You'd have to get up.
If I brought my camera, let's hope they don't step in it.
Hang on. No letting go.
This must be replica, huh?
No, I think that's original, yeah.
Oh, wow.
So you say there was a debate that didn't happen. But I mean, obviously it's something.
Excuse me.
Thank you.
gullible, isn't she? Oh man.
No, I did a camel already.
Top tier of the Northern Palace. Encampments right there, the square looking things. Hope these guys had a railing system. Here we are in Be'er Sheva.
Oh, there you go again. See, shut up.
Look at all that water. It's usually dry, right?
Oh yeah, more water.
Praise God.
You gotta take a picture of this then. A video.
Yeah. Now, this is the water system. Come over here.
Closer, see. See?
What?
See how
that's
much?
Crazy.
This was dug by our great grandfather Abraham. The source of water
is Abraham.
It's sitting under some of it. It's a huge aquifer. He knew that there should be water over here. Remember? He took Claude to a high place and he told him, choose the best part of the park you like. And he took, choose the best part. Sodom and Gomorrah and the whole Jordan Valley, which was nice, abundance of water and green. So he ended actually in the desert. So he started digging wells. Be'er Sheva. Okay, it's a Hebrew word, of course. Be'er is a well. Sheva is from seven. Okay? But actually, scholars do not believe it's from seven. Scholars believe that it is from the word lishvoa in Hebrew, which means oath, to make an oath. Remember, he did an oath over here with who? With Abimelech.
Yeah.
And they dug a well, and they said that would be a witness for the world deal or treaty together. So the well of oath, Be'er Sheva, and that is the well of our great grandfather Abraham.
Whoa.
Within
it, you'll see how deep it
is. That's gotta be 300. See the
water down
there.
Yeah.
Yeah, let me.
Yeah, I heard it.
Some pictures and come down and back to the bus.
And this was about the time of Abraham?
That was before even Abraham, but was highly developed during the time of Abraham.
Okay.
But this is a Canaanite town from the 5th century BC.
Oh, Canaanite. Okay.
Yep.
So they had their
idols. Oh, yeah.
These were found in Beersheba. This is the coolest museum I've ever been in. Reconstructed daggers. These are combs. 13th to 14th century. Of a cat. So much stuff.
это вход, и выход из колодки. Выходите сюда, и на улицу. На улице, если нет снега. Such as pottery and potsherds, stone and bone, papyrus and parchment. Inexpensive potsherds led to the widespread use of short notes. Papyrus was used for formal documents and parchment was used for sacred writings. Century Roman helmet, legionary helmet.
Fresh.
In your San Diego one, they're all tiny. That's the only thing, they're all small. Look at that. Look how big. This is Cape One, which if we get a chance to visit, this is one of the levels.
21st century. Looks like pictures of them.
Yeah.
can you point out Jerusalem? Yeah, where is it? Isn't that Jerusalem over there? Oh, I see it.
I'll give you an orientation from the top.
Okay, cool.
Concrete together, okay, a kind of concrete even, it was not known. This is a stacked stone. Okay, with all the dome was made out of rock, and it's fascinating. Let me see how muddy it is.
Oh, it's muddy.
Yeah. You see it above your head?
Oh, wow.
So that's the cold room, this is the middle room, and that is the hot room outside. They used to start actually from there. There's a corridor that used to bring to it, change there, sit in the middle room, and then of course go to the sauna room. The quality of water will stay in a good way, and the water will not seep through the cracks of the rock and lose it as well. So they have to plaster everything. That's why I told you admire the original plastering. This is new.
Right, right.
But there is original.
Low bridge.
Just to enjoy his time, the swimming pools down there. There's a huge swimming pool. It's all part of the premises of the fortress. The bathhouses, the scenery, and they said we need a theater as well, so that there would be plays and singers as well. So they built it over here for Tiberius, the son of Augustus. You're not listening to me, you cannot hear me, I'm explaining.
When you go down to the cave of the first of Christ, you will be going to it from the other side of the world, from the Catholic side. We have an entrance and an exit, one place or one side to descend down and then descend from the other side. Okay?
Can we take pictures?
Well, yes, you can. Yes, you can take pictures without a problem. Okay? And when you descend down, you will notice that you will descend in a flight of stairs. And as soon as you descend that flight of stairs, which is 14 steps, 1-4, on the right-hand side, there is the star of the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, the star of the Nativity. That star has been placed there only in the year 1881. In the
they do not get water on daily basis running through their houses. So they have to store the water on top with these big containers, so they will have always water running through their taps. And also notice the round white cylinders. They definitely have these solar panels on top of them for the hot water. Look at that beautiful house up to the right. See it? It's a three-story one. The long windows.